walked out in front of them, because the coppers were doing it. Indonesian coppers were doing it. Walked out in front of them and, you know, open hands, unarmed, and tried to calm them down. He got hit, I think, in the shoulder or the side of the face with a bit of shrapnel from one of the rocks, you know, bullets hitting rocks. Then he came back and everybody else, all the other DEOs, and apart from the Magnificent Seven, we call them, the Kiwis, the Yanks and the Aussies, everybody else had dived under the back of the Land Rovers in the riverbed. And they were advancing on us, and this two or three militia advanced on me. I was standing next to Morrow. And I thought, this is going to be bloody shitty. And I went to pick up a piece of bamboo to whack one of these bastards with. And it fell apart. It was full of white ants. And I just, you know, like you can imagine, full of adrenaline, scared, anxious, angry, frustration. I just burst into tears. And Morrow was trying to throw rocks at these bastards. And then suddenly somebody blew a whistle or something and they all backed off. But it was looking a bit hairy. So then Jeff negotiated that we would get, they would allow the UN Land Rovers to drive back to the police station, back down the riverbed, back to the police station. And then then he went up to the Polri commander's office and the TNI and negotiated the pickup of the remaining, but which was most of the ballot boxes, at the sports ground, if it was, you know, considered safe. So there, the Indonesians' job was to allay and keep the militia back and secure the LZ, basically, so the ballot boxes could go on. So this took a few hours. Then we radioed Dilly and told him, okay, you can come back now and pick up the remainder. And so they did. They flew in. And when they landed, not in the terms of agreement, the militia leader for that area with the Polri commander walked up to the chopper. He wanted to inspect it. There was no weapons or anything on board. And I said, geez, this could be a disaster. All he's got to do is have a grenade. Boom. Blow the chopper up. Throw it in. Boom. Yeah. Unbelievable. Anyway, we finally succeeded in loading all the ballot boxes on this Puma, and then it took off. And then the militia started coming in, like, yo, you've seen those African scenes, jackals come in, you know, and they started coming. So we all skivvied back to the police station. And there, then for the next 7 or 10 days, I got evacuated on the 7th, so it would be 7 or 8 days. How many days in August? 31 or 30? 31. So it's 31 days in August. I can't remember. Anyway, the ballot was this was on the 31st. So 7 days. So we called it the Siege of Gledow for 7 days. And then we all retreated back. Negotiations were made with the militia again. You're negotiating with thugs through the police who's supposed to be helping us and the TNI. We had to take all the DEOs and the civilian staff. A lot of them came from New York, but a lot of Australian DEOs, down to Dili. And the Kiwi police were evacuated. Their government pulled them out on the 31st or the 1st, I think, 31st or whatever. So they went down. And so Jeff asked for volunteers. So Morrow and I, and Randy and another Aussie copper, Peter Watt, we decided to take all the DEOs and civilian staff that wanted to be evacuated down to Dili. Not the Timorese staff, they were staying up there at this stage. So we loaded them all up, and then it was a series of roadblocks all the way down the mountain. I think it was about 2.5 hours driving over mountain roads, pretty dicey mountain roads, because you'd have a mountain on one side, the road would be on the side of it, and then a 600-foot drop. And the roads were terrible. And we had to negotiate in that trip alone a lot of militia roadblocks to get out. We had our police escort. Again, they did nothing. So we got all them down to Dili. Then we came back up. Then, because the situation in Glenno was getting really, really bad, against UN orders, we all decided that we would evacuate the Timorese that helped us during the whole of the period, the registrar, everything. If they wanted to come with their families, because we did a head count, we had enough Land Rovers, they wanted to be evacuated with their own, some of them had their own little tuk-tuk vehicles and all that. If they wanted to be evacuated, we'd take them. The UN directive had come out a few days before. No UN personnel, locally employed UN personnel to be evacuated. Now, it's that UN, yeah, it had to be bipartisan stuff. It happened in Croatia and Bosnia, yeah. The UN stood by while there were slaughters going because they were betwixt and between. So we said, no, this is BS. We'll if they want to come, we'll evacuate them. So we spread the word, went all around. They brought them in and we lined up a convoy of Land Rover at the front with Moro and I, Land Rover at the back with Randy and Pete, and all their little vehicles in the middle. And we evacuated 160 people, I think. About 160. So Jeff radioed Dili and said, you're not going to like this, but we're evacuating our staff because they're going to get killed, basically. And some of them already had been in the intervening period. So we're all lined up outside the police station. It was in the morning we decided to do it. The militia wouldn't lift their roadblock. Jeff negotiated them to lift that. This was over a period of hours. We had these people crammed into these vehicles. It was hot. We had bottles of water giving them tins of food. We were a bit ragged because we'd been through the same things as them for the last whatever months. And so we finally got the green light. It was about 5 or 6 o'clock again, 2.5 hour, 3 hour, depending on how many roadblocks and whatever. So it was going to be dark when we got there. So we went through, got through the main militia roadblock by negotiating and blah, 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 you know, the police let them out. So we went up through the mountain roads. We're in the front. And about halfway over the mountain range, it's pitch dark. We're going and Randy in the rear vehicle, the Yank, said, mate, I got a truckload of militia. And they're firing over my vehicle at the back because we couldn't hear that. We were right up the front of the convoy. They're firing over our back and then coming up and braking and swerving and trying to force me off the road down this valley. So he said, I'm going to do something. So what he did do, he told us when we got down to Dili, he let him get really close and hit the brakes because they weren't our vehicles. Hit the brakes. This truckload of militia swerved. And about 20 militia went over the side of the cliff. So that, gone. He said, all clear. So we kept going down. And unbeknownst to us, as we approached the outskirts of the Comoro Bridge near the airport in Dili, this truck came out of a side street with bloody a big sort of searchlight. And we thought it was militia, yeah, because Dili was riddled with militia. And so we told all the people in the back of all the vans, get down. So they got down, and they were all huddling in, looking inwards here. And this car screamed up alongside our car, who was first in the convoy. And do you know what it was? It was a CNN film crew. I mean, really? And this woman, yeah, leaned out of the car and she said, oh, you're the people evacuating the locals from Amira. We've heard it's really, you know, dangerous up there. Jesus Christ, I mean, yeah, like, really? Anyway, said a few things. And we finally got to the UN headquarters in Dili. Barrier went up, we all drove in. And one of the vehicles that had done the whole trip, as soon as the guy, it was one of the private vehicles, as soon as the guy turned off his motor, the whole gearbox and diff just dropped and big pools of oil in. So anyway, they knew we were coming, so the UN people came out, got all the locals, and they put them in the assembly hall because it was an old school, it was a high school. So got all them. there was people down in Dili, Australian police, that we knew, you know, that were on our contingent, and they knew what was happening. And we're sitting in the vehicle like, geez, a cup of coffee would have been good. I mean, yeah, we've just come through, you know, like a bit of hilly. And we got nowhere to go, so we thought we'd stay there the night. And this UN official, not an Australian, I might add, but a UN official came over and he said, you can't stay here. We've got no accommodation. Like gobsmacked. And Murrow, gave him the bird. Said, stuff here. And so we got out and they said, you can't go out there either. There's militia running everywhere. So we took off. And Murrow, who had been in Cambodia and Mozambique, he said, mate, my mate Mark Dodd, who is a journo for the Australian, and Hamish McDonald and Lindsay Murdoch, they're staying at the, I know they're here, they're staying at the Dili Hotel. We'll make a beeline for there. Randy said, no, mate, goes, I'm going off to where I know some American coppers are living. And Peter Watt went with him. So we went to the Hotel Turismo, I think it was, in Dili. And we went in and there's a whole heap of journos in there because this story had got around, right, that we'd evacuated all these people. So we went in there and we were just, you know, like about 6 days' growth, muddy. Yeah, all we'd had lately was, you know, free drinks, water and a can of spammed eggs or something. And so we went in there and the journos, being journos obviously, wanted the story. So this girl came up, I think she was an SBS, and she came up and she said, do you guys want something to eat? Please. So she made us, I always remember, it's a fond memory that Murrow's got too. She made us eat beautiful Timorese bread and big slices of fresh, you know, ham, proper ham, with mustard on it. Oh, we wolfed that down with a few beers. But because we were dehydrated and hadn't eaten and hadn't slept for a while, and Mark Doddy's mate wasn't in the group of journalists. So they're asking us questions, yeah. And we're a bit drunk by this stage, two cans of beer and we're going straight to our head. And we're getting a bit voluble, so saying what we did and telling what we did. And Mark Dodd came in and saw us and went over and said, enough, no more, these guys are bugging. I'm taking them. So, yeah, g'day, Mark, how are you? Because I knew Mark from Canberra anyway. And Murray, he was a good mate of Murray. So he took us off to get us out away from the, so, you know. So he took us up to his room and we had lots of coffee. And then those three journos, Lindsay, Hamish and Mark, were in a house right on the seafront. So we ended up going down there. And we stayed there that night. And I remember we spent the night lying on the bonnet of the car, listening to country and western music on the tape deck. Militia were going up and down outside the street. There was houses and again exploded. They were burning Dili. And we went inside and we had a bit of a war council. Could have got nasty. So we all armed ourselves, brackets. I had a piece of bamboo with some nails in it and Murrow had the same. Mark Dodd had a spear gun. And he wore his he had a pair of goggles on. Another guy had a tennis racket. And we rigged up on the front door that they'd have to burst into if they came to get us, because they knew where all the journos were living. We rigged up a rock booby trap. We tied it up. So as soon as I opened the door, the first guy in it get a flat head. So we rigged all that up and we got bourbon. They had, and I don't know where they got all the, they got heaps of bourbon. We hadn't seen this stuff. We'd been drinking Bintang beer, which was not a bad beer, actually. And so we're in bourbon, and apparently I was standing up, talking to, you know, Doddy and Lindsay and all that, and I just passed my glass to one of them, and I just collapsed onto the bed. And apparently I was laid out like this, and they put my hands like I was in a coffin. And apparently I was like that at 7 o'clock in the morning. I didn't move. And I was woken up by the smell of cooking. And it was Hamish or Lindsay cooking bacon and eggs. Like, Yeah, like the shark in Finding Nemo. Gary goes, blood, you can smell the blood in the water. It was like, oh, good. Yeah, so we got up and had that. And then Morrow and I had a quick look around, and we wanted to get back up the mountain. So we walked out and had a look up and down this road that goes along the seafront. And on the two big pillars outside the driveway into this house that they were staying was two big red crosses. So we went back and then we looked at a few other houses and there was no red crosses. There was just that, and the Australian, they'd been there for about 2 months staying. So the local bad guys knew exactly where these Aussies were staying. So we went back and talked to Tom, Mark and Lindsay at home. And they said, so what do you, that doesn't look good. So we had to have, that's right. Morrow and I, and we teamed back up with the Yank, Randy and Peter. We went to local police headquarters in Dili to get permission to go up. And they said, you can't go up. It's a forbidden zone. They use these stupid terms, yeah, forbidden zone. So weren't getting anywhere there. So we went back to Mark and we said, looks like you got us for at least another night, mate. So we had another big bourbon night, and Hamish or Lindsay had been out and got some beautiful French pastries, so we ate all that stuff. And getting a little bit sick of Garth Brooks by this stage because I only had a few tapes. And then we went back to think. So they said, oh, yes, we will give you a police escort back. Oh, that's right. No, sorry. God, sorry. In the intervening stuff, that night, sorry, before Mark, when Mark got us away from all the journalists, Tim Fisher, Maurice Payne, and was it Simon Crean? Three politicians were staying there. They were up oversighting the election on the 30th. They were doing a bit of a trip around, going to Orchard, all over East Timor. They were there, and Tim Fisher and Maurice Payne and Simon Crean were all flying back to Canberra the next day. They heard that we were in the Hotel Turismo. They heard what had happened with Glenoe evacuating all these people. They sent a message down, and one of the staff came in and said, look, Tim Fisher, do you guys want to talk to Tim? He's flying out and he wants to have a chat to you guys. So Tim, in his inimitable way, and I'd met him when I worked with Bob Hawke. So he said, what are you, Jesus. And I knew Maurice Payne really well. And I'll tell you a side story later on about Maurice Payne. She saved my life just before I flew out to Darwin. Anyway, we went in there and had a bit of a chat. And Tim, as he always did when he took notes, copious notes, opened this big, like a ledger, got his pen out and he was starting right. And he said, right, you're from Glenoe. We've heard about the riverbed incident, the incident at Sabe where Phil Hunter saved a guy, well, dragged a guy out away from the militia who'd stabbed him, and he died later on, and Phil and Max Noth had carried him up under all this gunfire and up into the house where he died, sadly. So they knew about that. They knew about Glenoe. They knew about Amira. They'd heard that. So Tim's writing all these notes. And Maurice was saying, so we'd finished that. We had a beer and he said, I'm going back to brief Parliament tomorrow. And he did. And the story that we told him is in Hansard, apparently. Maurice said to me, she said, Don, what's happening with you staying in Dili now? And I said, no, Maurice, there's four of us and we're going back to Glenoe. She said, you can't, you're mad. You can't go up there. It's too dangerous. And I said, well, yeah, but that's where all our colleagues are. Anyway, she probably never thought she'd see me again, but anyway, so we did that. And then after 2 days of negotiating with the Pori in Dili, we secured a police escort back up the road. So we went through all the roadblocks that we'd fought our way through before, got our way back. And then the siege started, and then then the police commander, before he got evacuated, the Polri police commander said, you guys want to, for safekeeping, come in and throw your sleeping bedrolls down in the police station. So, yeah, that's probably a good idea. So we did that, and So that night, we had all these coppers, and I think I've got a photo somewhere of all lying around with their mozzie nets over us in this area, and we're all just sort of, you know, eating ration packs and sleeping because we're tired. But that night, I woke up for a nocturnal wee, and I went outside, and I said to Morrow, mate, do you get a funny feeling about what's happening around here? Why were we invited into here? He said, yeah, I was thinking about that. So we didn't go back inside. We stayed outside and we got back into our Land Rover. And during the night, about 3 a.m. in the morning, there was Elvis with his Ray-Bans on at 3 a.m. in the morning. I mean, cool, too cool for school. And the TNI commander, Kapasis and TNI commander. The police commander was nowhere to be seen. He had a little house on the premises, but he was nowhere to be seen. And they were going around all the little hoochies around the place, pointing out, and it was only the Australians sleeping in there under their mozzie nets. None of the Thais, none of the Pakistan, none of the Yanks. It was just the Australians. So I went back in, woke Jeff up and said, mate, I think in the morning we better go. This has just happened. And he agreed. So we left. That day, the police commander was taken down to Dili because he was helping us a lot. He was a nice guy, as I said. He was a really nice. So that didn't go well with the authorities. I hope he was all right back in Indonesia or whatever. So he was probably taken back to Indonesia. It's all conjecture. But anyway, the next day, we went up to where Jeff had his house. Our bad manner, meanwhile, while I was down in Dili, our bad manner, where Morrow and I and the Kiwis and the Spanish, that had been burnt down. So we had nowhere to go. All our stuff had gone. So we went up to where Jeff and three or four New York DEOs and UN people, staff, had been living before we evacuated them. And there was just Jeff up there and he said, mate, there's three houses, they're vacant, come up here. So we stayed there. And we stayed there for about the next 5 days. Meanwhile, we barricaded the door. Morrow and I did a quick trip down to the market to see if there was anything left. We got the last remains of a carton of Bintang beer. We threw that in the Land Rover, took it up. Found a few jerry cans of fuel and we loaded all, filled up most of the Land Rovers. We were told by Dili to go back to the UN police station, which we'd locked up, but it was still, you know, all the windows were broken, and evacuate and save all the equipment, the computers, and that was a stupid order. So there's a photo of me throwing about three toilet rolls. You know, if they want everything, they can get the bog rolls too. So we threw them in, all the pens and pencils, and yeah, like just stupid stuff. And then we went back up, and for the next 5 days, there was militia everywhere. They're still burning Glen-O, shootings. We were told in that period that the daughters of one of the local Timorese that had helped us were being raped about 500 metres away. And I knew them. They were from the village of Amira. So we told Jeff and I said, mate, I know it's pointless probably, but we'll just, Morrow and I stayed together the whole time. So we piled in the Land Rover, got a pickaxe each. We went down, then we got broken windows in the Land Rover and we couldn't even get near these girls. And they'd been raped and I think they were killed later on. So, yeah, that sort of stuff was happening all over Glen-O. So we went back and in that period there was mainly Australian, the Kiwis had gone, so there was Australian Americans. All the other UN police, they'd found other places because they never seemed to be around when you really needed them, so they'd gone off and skived. And while we were still down at the UN police station at Glen-O, Jeff was doing a head count of all the coppers. And he said, where are the two Malaysian police? And Morrow and I, on our one little rounds around the police station, you know, crawling through the corn pod things, cornfield, we'd seen the two Malaysian coppers over at the Polri police station, taking off their Malaysian police shirts and putting on a Polri Indonesian police t-shirt because they spoke Indonesian. They were Muslims and they were looking after themselves. So we told Jeff, and in time of war, that's shooting by firing squad stuff. I mean, that's traitors. Anyway, so he was still, his brief was still to look after all the coppers of all the nations, which he did really good. But in these three houses, there was only Australians and Yanks. And there was a few, everybody was getting a bit frayed and nervous and whatever. So we drank up a beer and the nerves were, getting really sort of tight. So I yelled out to him and I said, guys, Murray's got a book that his girlfriend had sent over. It was called Birdsong by Sebastian Fuchs. Have you read it? Beautiful book. I think there's a movie made of it, actually. It's a beautiful story. And I said, it's a love story. So I said, Murray and I got the last bit of beer that was down the marketplace that wasn't trampled or destroyed. So I said, grab yourself a warm beer and Murray will read you a passage. So I said, Murray, bloody find a good one, mate. So there's a few saucy paragraphs. So, Randy, one of the Yank coppers, that Yank bloke, lovely bloke, he took a photo and it was all these, like grown coppers sitting on the floor, with a can of beer, just listening to Murray read. And it was just beautiful, And so then Randy, who wrote beautiful poems, he had a book of poems, he read, I said to Randy, because Randy and I did a few patrols together, and he was a really, really nice guy. And I said, mate, read him that poem, Angels' Wings Are Fragile Things. And what I was trying to do, because there's a lot of guys that hadn't been on missions, Murrow had, Jeff Hazel had, but he was in another house. And Randy had been in Vietnam and the US Seabees. So there was a bit of experience and some inexperience. So we tried to calm everybody down because it was mayhem outside. We were looking out the windows that we'd bloody boarded up with mattresses. And they were walking around throwing grenades into bloody houses and bloody shooting. And, this was going on for about 5 days. It was just unbelievable. He read out the poem and calmed a few people down. And there's a photo of Randy and I spooning in bed because there's hardly any beds left in this place. So we both cared about to turn over. And so then Jeff still had a radio in his little house, which was next door. Our evacuation date was the 7th, I think, 7th of September. So Jeff came into our house, got in by the back door. And said, right, we're going to get all the vehicles, going to line up outside the police station, and we're all going. So he rang around, radios, got all the remaining nationality police that were all over the place. We all got our vehicles, line up there, big convoy. There's a photo of the last convoy. So we lined up outside the police station. And I've got a photo of me just standing looking at the vehicles, and it was pretty, not pretty emotional, it was really emotional. As we went out, the militia had got all the locals that lived in Gleno, lined them up, because for the 2.5 months that I was there anyway, these people loved us, they were waving to us, we used to chat and have coffee with them and talk and laugh, and they'd lined them up as we drove out, and the message was very clear. There goes your, because we kept telling the villagers all the time, we will stay, even if it gets pear-shaped, we will stay and help you. Well, we were ordered out. We had to get out. They were evacuating UNAMET from East Timor. We didn't realise that. We thought we'd stay until then another contingent would come in and it'd go on. We thought it would peak and then go back down, but it didn't. It was getting worse and worse and worse. So they'd lined them all up, and these bastards were standing behind these rows of villagers with weapons as we drove past on our last convoy. And instead of looking at us and laughing and waving like they did. They didn't dare. They were all just, you know, because that then they almost raised Glenno to the ground and killed a lot of people there. So we got through and we're on this convoy and we're going through the mountain, near the mountain pass where Randy had turfed off this truckload of militia. And suddenly one of the choppers, and it was a Huey chopper, aka Back to Vietnam, wok, 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 and it was coming in and they were radioing through and they were on the radio saying, guys, they didn't tell us what was that. They said there's a lot of militia lining roads, hiding in the bushes and the jungle and everything all the way back. So just be really careful. But as we got to this really dangerous stretch where the road was curving around, there's a mountain that side, valley that side, the chopper came down, hovered like on a ridge line there, hovered and then took off and then dived down into the valley, then suddenly reappear there and come in and hover, hover, hover. Fast forward when we got evacuated to Darwin, one of the pilot of that chopper, Lloyd's chopper, he was having a few beers in one of the bars in Darwin. We recognised, he said, oh, you guys are Mary, yeah, yeah, yeah. And they said, you're in that convoy. We said, yeah, yeah, what were you doing? The bloody T&I and the militia had set up an ambush with a machine gun on this pass. Because if they opened up and hit the lead vehicle, and the last vehicle, you had nowhere to go except over the cliff. And this chopper saw it, unarmed chopper, came down, hovered over the thing, really pissed them off. And then when they, you know, tried to get the dive just back into the valley and then come up somewhere else. And they hovered there till all the convoy went through, the 12, 14 odd Land Rovers. We got down into Dili, past the big militia headquarters that was near the Camaro Bridge near the airport. And we went to the transport compound, which was not a transport compound. Now, everybody had left there and got up into headquarters in Dili. So we stayed there. Then we got radioed, come up to the main headquarters. The force commander wants to have a word briefing, blah, blah, blah. So we went up there. All the locals were still there in the assembly hall. They'd been there for that 7, 8 days, 9, 10 days. They were all coming in from all over Dili, and that's when those scenes, remember, where they, a lot of them were outside. The militia started firing and the T&I started firing. There was evidence that militia and the T&I had fired at locals and killed them. And the mothers had thrown their babies over the razor wire that was on the perimeter fence around UN headquarters in Dili. And a lot of them got, yeah, like razor wire, it's terrible. And they were throwing their babies over because we couldn't get the staff that were there, couldn't get the one door through the wall open. And then finally a bloke called Dave Savage got the door open and then they were passing these kids through and then getting the mums and dads in, you know, and then locked the door. So while we were there waiting for this briefing, we were watching locals running up the mountain behind the UN headquarters at Dili and being shot at by bloody militia and T&I here, and bodies. Like, they were running up the hill over because it was thicker jungle on the other side, and they were off there. Everybody was evacuated because Dili was in flames. We get the briefing, and because Morrow and I had been on the first lift in on the 21st of June, we were on the first lift, going to be on the first lift out. So our names were thing, and just as they read out our names, and then Jeff, there was lots of noise going on, rifle shots and grenades and it. There was a single sinister rifle shot, and I was standing next to Jeff listening to Alan Mills giving us this briefing, telling us that we're all a bit, you know, panicky and they didn't really have, you know, proper weapons and, you know, then there'd be a burst of automatic gunfire. Anyway, and there was a single shot and Jeff was next to me and Mara was there. And Jeff just collapsed. What would you immediately think? Hit by a sniper. So we rolled on him and we looked around at, like, Is anybody can help? There was coppers from all different everywhere. They'd all pissed off. So we looked over and I'm bloody feeling for blood, you know, like rolling. And he was unconscious. And he got hit in the cheek or the shoulder back in Glenna. But we're all dehydrated and he just collapsed from exhaustion, dehydration, you know, strain. Anyway, we found out he was all right. So he was put on the first lift out too. And so, and the story continues a little bit. Sorry, it is a long story. But so our names were read out. Yeah, grab your bags. And we had our runaway packs, but we'd left them when we dumped the vehicles in the school playground next year, the other side of this wall. And I said, tomorrow, mate, we're going in about 2 or 3 hours, but I've got some shit in that bag that I want, you know. And he said, yeah, so have I. I've got some stuff, yeah. So we, bloody, there was stuff going on. So we crawled through under the wall, under the wire, and we crawled in amongst all this park of UN vehicles. They all had broken windows, bullet holes in them and everything. We found our vehicle. We opened the back door, got out our little runaway packs with our personal, you know, little bit of personal stuff. And then we crawled all the way back. And when we got back in, one of the Aussies looked down and said, you bastard, man. You nearly got killed. You might have got killed, what, for a bag, pack? Yeah, well, yeah, there's stuff there that I wanted. You know, new pair of undies or something. And so we did that. Then we got in the vehicle and every convoy that had gone in the previous week to Dili Airport for whatever reason had been ambushed by militia. And because of our experience up the hill, we were dealing with those bad militia all the time. I just said to the UN, he was an American or a Brit UN copper, controlling the convoy movement, you know, how many vehicles, whatever. And I went up to him and he said, well, you guys are on the next convoy. And I said, and he said, you'll have a hairy trip because everybody had been shot at and chased by militia all the way through Dili. And I said, just a point of interest, do you tell the Polri that there's a convoy coming in at, say, 2 o'clock or what? Do you tell them? He said, yeah, we have to. I said, big mistake, huge. You don't tell them because you tell the Polri. They tell T&I, T&I tells the militia, and they're waiting for you. So can we just try something? We had a convoy of 4 vehicles. And so we'd got the vehicles that were working. And a lot of them were ours from Glenno and Amira and Hatalia and that. I said, let's not, just one convoy. It's on our heads. We've all agreed. Don't tell them. Don't tell anybody. We'll just go, right? So come the appointed hour, we knew it was about a 30-minute drive. So we all took off and we're driving through. No problems. There was stuff happening all around, but you drive down streets. Yeah, we knew Dili pretty well. We drive down streets. But then there was this big camp of militia right near that Cornrow Bridge. That was their headquarters. And it was just like Keystone Cops, right? It was like something, the double take. There's this convoy of 4 UN Land Rovers. Oh, that's right. We're driving along. And the Land Rover that I was in started like, we were doing about 30, 40 Ks an hour, started, and I said to Brett Swan, the Aussie that was at Hatalia driving us, he was doing the shuttle service. I said, mate, Jesus, bro, what's wrong? And he said, I don't know. Anyway, it's like bloody Keystone Cops, cough, farting, and the blokes up the back of the convoy, the other 3 vehicles, hey, Jesus, what are you guys doing? We weren't going to stop and get out and have it, you know, give it a service. So we're going past, and all these militia were all sitting around, lying around outside their headquarters, drinking beer and, you know, oh, yeah, isn't it fun, massacring and raping and pillaging and all this, bastards. And as they went past, because they hadn't been told, it was classic. They went, what? Bloody UN? Oh, they all piled and tried to get back on the back of their bloody stupid trucks. And then they chased us. So they came in behind us. And meanwhile, we're farting our way to the airport. It was just over the bridge and down the road to the airport. And when we got in, you know, and then they stopped because there was Australian soldiers, and I know who they were. They were 2 Squadron SAS because I walked up to, they were all standing around the perimeter of the airfield. They had pistols. They didn't have long rifles, right? Didn't have their weapons. But they all had a box, and that's where their box. They weren't allowed to be obviously armed, apart from personal weapon. So they were standing there. Anyway, we went through and then we got out of the car and I said to Brett, what's the bloody problem? We never found out until we got back to Darwin. What had happened was the three other vehicles in the convoy were from Dili, the supply vehicles in Dili. Ours was from, it was his vehicle from Hatalia. It was the dry season. We're in the mountains. The dust was like bull dust. Over the whole time we were there, we got them serviced about once every month or something, yeah. But over the time it was there, all this bull dust had got into the air filter. In the dry season, it was no problem. Came down to Dili, the humidity was about 90%. The humidity got into the bull dust in the air filter, clogged it up. So ripped off the air filter, problem solved. Anyway, we got through and then we had to go through customs at Dili Airport. Meanwhile, Dili's burning. It's a nightmare. We had to go through, we had a little bag. Open it up, like they had to show. The press were there, had a show of, you know, one handkerchief, a pair of thongs and a shaving brush or something. Anyway, then we got on the plane. It was a RAF C-130, I think it was. So we got on, but on the way over to the rear ramp, I went over to one of these soldiers and I said, who are you guys? They said, oh, we're just here to make sure everything's okay. I said, you're a regiment, aren't you? He said, oh, no, not really. And I said, mate, I was 2 squad in Vietnam. And the bloke said, excuse the French, mate, you're too old for this fucking shit, I tell you. And I said, I know, I'm too old. And tell me, B, he said, you look like shit. And people kept telling me this. And I mean, yeah, it's like, I started to believe it. Anyway, we got on and guess who was already on the plane? Sitting right, if you've ever been on a C-130, there's, you know, you come up the back ramp. I used to jump out of them in the regiment, but you come up the back ramp and there's a row of seats outward facing in the middle, and then there's seats along each side. Right up the front, underneath, there's a little couple of steps and you get up into the cockpit where the pilots are. Right underneath, right at the first seats, were the two Malaysian coppers. They had found their Malaysian police shirts and put them back on again. And somehow, not in our convoy, they abandoned us back at Glenner. They had found their way out by talking to militia and T&I, all their little buddies, and they got on first on the plane. Morrow was going to kill them. I said, mate, probably not a good look. There's too many witnesses. They'll get their just desserts, right? So anyway, we got on and he was seething. Then we took off. Because militia, this regiment guy said, mate, there's militia everywhere. They're all over the place. Because the airport was surrounded by, you know, grass and bushy stuff. And apparently there was, when they flew in, they could see the bus, you know, hiding in the whatever. They didn't fire, as far as I know, they didn't fire because they didn't dare at these planes coming and taking off. So when we took off, one of the final scenes was, as we took off, apparently there was a kangaroo operation, one of those kangaroo exercises in Darwin, nicely timed because Interfet was going in at the end of September or something. As we took off, two, I think they were Singaporean fighters, came each side of our... As each plane took off, there was a bit of a ritual, apparently. They were doing exercises out over the Arafura Sea or whatever it was. But as each UN plane was coming in and taking off because of the threat from militia, possible, because, yeah, you shoot a plane down, a lot of people die, they'd come in and just shepherd on each of the wings. And I looked at Morrow and I said, mate, the sounds of choppers took me back to Vietnam. When I flew into Vietnam 30 years before, as we flew into Saigon, the war was going on big time, two American F-4 Phantoms came and shepherded the Qantas 707 plane on the way in. Now we're flying out and we're shepherded by two fighter planes. I think they were Singaporean. And I said, the parallels between here and Vietnam are chilling because we left Vietnam and we left the war and we all know what happened there. We said we'd stay in Timor and we're leaving. Not happy, Jan. Yeah, not happy. And he wasn't, you know, none of us were happy. We were all pissed off that we were ordered out. So we were ordered. And we got into, flew into Darwin Airport. I think it was night time when we landed. And right at the foot of the plane, when they let the ramp down, was the Deputy Commissioner of the AFP, Adrian Waddett, who knew me really quite well and knew that I had quite a fair bit to do with the decision not to go with weapons. And he said, Jesus, he said it again, another person. He said, Jesus, Barney Murray, you look like shit. And you smell. And I said, Jesus, Adrian, I'm getting a complex here. And he said, mate, I'm flying back to Canberra tonight. Before I go and go over there, there's like CWA ladies, you know, that when they evacuated Dunkirk, there was sandwiches and cup of tea. Go over there. Before you go over there, he said, I'm flying back tonight. Mick Palmer and John Howard want to know, was it a good idea? And I knew what he meant. Was it a good idea to go without weapons? And I said, mate, you wouldn't be talking to us now. There were so many instances that if we had have gone armed with a pistol, the world would have known that police were armed. It was only a police operation. Police were armed. But I said, I know my weapon handling skills, and most of the police in the AFP contingent were pretty proficient with weapons. But I said, we're working with Indians, Pakis, Nigerians, all this. I don't know, a lot of them probably have never seen a gun, and if they, what, give them a 5-hour course or something? And I said, if we're in a confrontational situation and we were armed and the world knew we were armed and somebody panicked or went for a handkerchief, they could have shot us and said they went for their weapons. Sorry, yeah. But if the world knows we're armed, we'll still be dead. But, mate, they ain't going to get away with that. What are you going to get out of your pocket if you're unarmed? A handkerchief? So he said, that's all I need to know. He said, look after yourselves. I'll be flying back up to Darwin in a couple of days' time. So we staggered over to these gorgeous CWA ladies. And they looked at us as if we were something from Mars. And wolfing sandwiches down and bloody, there was little things of orange juice on the C-130 coming over and grapes or something. Yeah, but we were starving. Anyway, we ate that. Then we were bussed to Larrakia Barracks in Darwin. That was our first night. We had nothing with us. So we had quite a fitful night. I didn't sleep. I don't think Morrow slept really. Then the AFP gave us $200 because they knew most of us didn't have a lot of, most of our stuff had been pinched, burnt, whatever. So they bussed us into Darwin and we're in dirty uniform. We had had a shower that night and we stood under the shower for about, you know, 3 or 4 hours, you know, just like hot water, flush toilets, because we had just a hole in the ground up at Glenna, I mean, you know, and cold baths with a bloody plastic jug. And so I went into, Mara and I went into Woolies or something. And, you know, we had all of this money. So I bought a couple of pairs of shorts. I bought a pair of boat shoes, leather boat shoes, which I've still got. But when I got back to the, and we went to a hotel then. When we got back to the hotel, Mara said, do you know where these boat shoes are made, Barney? He said, Indonesia. I nearly threw them out the window. But anyway. And we bought a couple of T-shirts and whatever. But I bought some shaving gear. And because my mind was like, we were just a bit, you know, out of there. I'd bought 2 of those aerosol things of underarm instead of 1 underarm and 1 shaving cream. And then we got back to Larrakia Barracks, you know, and we got our stuff and I was in there and I was spurting the stuff. I'd had another long shower. I said, Morrow, this stuff's crap. It's not this. Underarm, mate. You're squirting underarm on yourself. No wonder it's not foaming up. Anyway, one night at Larrakia, then they put us in the travel lodge, I remember. And there was quite a few police there, about probably 10 or 20. But they'd overbooked with a Japanese tour group. So who'd they kick out? Us. So we're out on the pavement again with our little pack. Like, hello, what are we going to do here? Warren Snowden, who I knew well from working for Bob Hawke, he saw Morrow, and we went and got a coffee somewhere and sat down, and he was at his electorate. And he was trying to come over, and he said, "Jesus, Barney, you look like shit." And I've had 100 people that said that, and I was really starting to get worried. Anyway, I'd shaved by this stage. And he said, "So you heard about it. Geez, how was it?" Yeah, had a bit of a coffee and had a bit of breakfast. And he said, where are you staying?" He said, "Well, we were staying up there, but now we're out. They've kicked us out because they'd overbooked." So anyway, he saw the police. They'd set a police team up, from Canberra to deal with all the admin stuff. Put people here, there, and everywhere. And they were running out of rooms, like hotel rooms. I don't know what was on in Darwin at that stage, but there was something on. There was no rooms. But as luck would have it, walking down the main street of with a pair of footy shorts and a T-shirt on and our pack, a little pack, full now of our police clothes, all rolled up, washed at Larrakia, but dirty, dusty boots, I ran into Ingrid Hayden. She had been evacuated out with Sergio De Mello, but they were staying at whatever the ritzy, ritzy hotel in Darwin is, the Continental or something. She was in a bloody suite up the top, and she said, "Oh, my buddy, God, yeah." And chat, caught up, And because I knew her and her sister Georgia really well. And she said, "Where are you?" And I said, "Well, nowhere at the moment. We're waiting to get notified if we can go somewhere because all the places are all full up." And she said, "Come up and stay with me." So I said, "Morrow?" He said, no, bring him up. I'll get two rollaways." So we stayed in her suite. It was as big as this room. And we just had, stuff. So we gave her privacy. And as a thank you, I had nothing. I gave her the police shirt that I had on. She says, she rang. I get a Christmas card from the Haydens every year, but Bill and Dallas. And I always say to the kids, Kirk. And she said years ago now, she said, "I've still got that police shirt," because then she went back to New York. And I don't think she was with Sergio De Mello when he was killed in Baghdad. But so I've still got that police shirt. But anyway, we spent about a week or 10 days in Darwin. We all got medicals. Most of us had worms. I was diagnosed with typhoid and dengue. A bloke called Max Noth had cerebral malaria. He could have died. There was no facility backup in East Timor when we were there. The UN, have a couple of dispirin. I had dengue. I hope you never get dengue. It's like the worst headache you can ever imagine. A migraine on steroids. We just spent a whole week of drinking and carrying on. I arranged with the chief medical officer, Klaus Zobin, and I said, "Mate, massages." I said, "Could you get the permission? There's a really good massage place down around the waterfront at Darwin." And I said, "All these guys, and you've seen them all, because they brought a psych up, and I couldn't talk to the psych. Morrow couldn't talk to the psych. We were just too wired, and she didn't push the right buttons. And I knew Sonia really well from WITSEC days, and." I said, "Sorry, Sonia, look, nothing against you, but I just can't talk about this. It's too raw." So I said, "How about, springing for two massages for everybody that's in Darwin?" He said, "You're a really good idea." So he set up an account at this massage place. I told people, and through the grapevine they got told, went down, had two massages, and we got food, we got fed, so that was pretty good. But then the new contingent came in that was going to replace us, and they were held back because the situation was getting worse. And then in that intervening period, then Interfet went in. So they went in with Interfet. The last of our guys come out about the 12th of September, I think. I think Interfet, I don't know, you can do 15th, 17th of September. But before we got taken to our respective Sydney, Melbourne, Canberra, whatever. We had a big briefing. The purpose was we were going to brief the new coppers going over as to what it was like. And came around to my turn, and I got up, and the commissioner was there, Mick Palmer was there. I got up, I started to cry, and I started to talk, and then I just break down. I cried. And a bloke I joined the police force with, it was a Navy bloke during Vietnam, he was like really worried because he said, mate, I have seen you a lot and I've never seen you like this. I was just a mess. So they diagnosed me with typhoid dengue and worms and whatever, and gave us all these bombs. But they let me go on the plane back to Canberra. And then I went to the international health people in Canberra and got all some more blood tests. And she said, you've got typhoid. We're going to quarantine you. And I just sort of driven in that day for a quick medical, thinking I'd have a bit of a chat. And she put me on quarantine at Waden Valley Hospital. But before that, this part of the story, you know, like front page, you know, Australian police evacuated out of Darwin, you know, did this, did that. And she said, I just read the paper. She said, I've seen what you guys did. Well, that was the button. Being told what we did was good. That was the button. I just broke down. I couldn't leave her office to go to quarantine for 4.5 hours. She put me in a side office and I was just a mess. So I had some psych stuff and it was shitty. But it was good. A mate of mine from the regiment came over. He had a book fair or something, and I was in Vietnam with him. And I had coffee in Manuka with him. And something happened. He talked about, and I just broke down crying again. He said, mate, he said, Jesus Christ. He said, you're been, and I always remember his words, you're been to the well of courage too often. And he said, mate, the effing well's dry. Don't go back ever. Because they asked me to go back about two years after that, and I said no. I was out then. I was out again. Then I went up and worked at Parliament House for a while. And no, I couldn't go. It was just some of our guys did go back for a bit of closure to see how it had progressed. But the best thing we did, and I don't know if you want to have this on the interview, but in 2019, five of us that were in on that contingent went back to Timor for the 20th anniversary of the poll and the independence vote. And we went back and we were all anxious because, again, we had told the Timorese and believed it that we would stay even and we will try and help you and protect you even if it goes to custody. Well, we ended up not being able to do that and we were taken out. So we went back and we were in Sydney. We flew up from Canberra, stayed overnight Sydney at the airport, and then we flew out the next morning. I saw all the guys, the five, having breakfast, and I said, guys, I don't think I'll go. It cost me $2,000 or something, airfares to Timor via Darwin. I was going to pull out. I said, I don't think I can do this. And Dave Savage, who you've probably heard about, he said, because I didn't sleep, I was having dreams all night. And he was similar, but we were talked into going by the other three. And we did go, so we overnight down, and then we flew over to Timor. And we're on a civvy flight. We pulled up. The hostess got everybody else off. There was five of us. Everybody else off the plane. We said, what's going on? And one of us looked out window of the thing to the terminal and there was all these Timorese school kids lined up and officials and we walked off and they just, you know, they were happy to see us, not unhappy to see us. They were just like, yeah. And we spent 2 weeks there. It was just gorgeous. And I'm on tape saying 20 years ago, gunfire and screams. Now music and laughter. It was just It was just, yeah, it was really good. Went to my village. Oh, just an aside to that. There's always stories. I wake up the warm mornings, you know, and I got a whole heap of photos blown up to A4 size of people's faces from Amira and Glenno. I took them over thinking when I was going back, thinking I might be able to find out what happened to them. So, and we were accompanied by an SBS film crew, and our story is told on Dateline or Insight, one or the other. Anyway, they stayed with us in Dili, and they knew I was going back to Glenno that day because that was my village. So they came with us and they were filming me in the back of their vehicle going up. And as we went through past where that bastard of a roadblock was and a little bridge going into Glenno, the TNI barracks then is now the police station. They had rebuilt most of Glenno. We pulled in, unannounced, you know, didn't have any. And I had these photos and the film crew was following me in, and I went up to, there was a sergeant there, East Timor Police, not Indonesian, East Timor Police. And I went up and through the interpreter there with him, told him the story. And I said, I'm here because I was here 20 years ago during the troubles and the vote. So he just went blah, blah, blah. And before he knew it, I was surrounded by East Timorese police, all looking at me. And it was all being filmed. And then I can't remember the guy's name. It's on the Dateline show or Insight. He was asking me questions. And I had all these photos lined out on the big table. And one of the police women, the amazing things happened. One of the little police women came over. She's looking over my shoulder. I'm being filmed, looking over, and she's looking. That was her as a 14-year-old girl, and the young teenage boy beside him ended up marrying. And she's now a police officer. So this was all on, and then I was telling, I wish I could remember, I'm having a senior moment, this SBS guy, the journo, about that rape incident and some of the murders. And she was just standing there crying and nodding. I know. She said, I know. I saw it. She was there. She lived there. Her parents were killed. Unbelievable.
It's
unbelievable.